Hello, guys. Welcome to our live show about Best Served Cold by Joe Abercrombie.
Thank you for coming. Were we supposed to bring our book over? Because I didn't.
No, it's okay. I've got it. It was an easy spot. Welcome, you guys. I'm so glad you guys are here. We're going to have a fun show tonight. Hopefully a lot of arguing. That was my point to bring all these people on here, that we were going to get feisty about it. So I'm going to let everyone introduce themselves. Jimmy, why don't you start?
Oh, all right. Well, I am the BookTube Beefcake, Jimmy Nuts, and I'm from the Fantasy Network channel, where I cover a wide variety of fantasy books. And I guess I should probably state why I'm here, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Give me a mission statement.
I think it's not a super popular opinion to say that Best Served Cold is my least favorite of the standalones. And first of all, I still think it's a great book, but on the scale of Joe Abercrombie, it goes down towards the bottom edge for me. Still a great book, but for Joe, I think he did better with some of the other works he had. So I'm excited to be here.
Perfect. Jake, why don't you introduce yourself?
I don't have any fancy titles. I just go by my name, Jake Bishop. And I also think Best Served Cold is the worst Abercrombie of the standalones. So basically me and Jimmy are in a complete agreement. I DNF'd it halfway through. I didn't care what was going on. And I haven't looked at a summary because I only care about what happens to one of the characters, and I just ask I've read the stuff after. In general, I do really like the Abercrombie books, but man, this book didn't work for me. I also talk about fantasy books and allegedly also sci-fi, but pretty much mostly fantasy.
Oh yeah, I don't. What is our policy on spoilers today?
I'm assuming
I should
everything.
Say it's a full spoiler live. And we'll probably spoil a little bit of First Law trilogy as well, just by the nature of characters reappearing. So you've been warned.
Obviously, we won't spoil after Best Served Cold, especially since Hillary hasn't read after
Best Served Cold. I haven't read any of them, so you can't.
Well, I can, you can't, but I won't.
And Liene.
I'm Liene from Liene's Library. I'm a big, big fan of Joe Abercrombie. Until the new trilogy started coming out, Best Served Cold, I was on record as being my favorite First Law book. But then it was dethroned by A Little Hatred, and then A Little Hatred was dethroned by The Trouble with Peace. But I still think it's the best of the standalones. So that's why I am here, to defend its good name.
And I am Bookborn from the channel Bookborn. And I talk about fantasy and allegedly sci-fi, just like Jake says, but mostly fantasy, adult fantasy. And I am in the middle. I was hyped up Best Served Cold like by a lot of people after I finished First Law and loved it. And it was fine. Like, Joe Abercrombie is a good writer. So everything he writes is good writing. And so it was good, but it kind of fell flat compared to First Law. So that's where I'm in the middle. I think I could be swayed. I think you guys could sway me either way. So I'm here for that.
All right. It's on.
Maybe if we get to the end of the live, we'll have time to compare First Law to Way of Kings. I have a lot of opinions about that.
I'm sure
you guys do too.
So we'll definitely have different opinions among the four.
That'll be spicy.
We'll get to, if it's not spicy enough, we'll get to that one.
Yeah, we're gonna try not to do anything that leads to any like vendettas being sworn. But
yeah, let's remain friends. Hopefully, I was gonna start off right away. I just want to talk about the characters. Well, actually, first let me ask a question. We all love the First Law trilogy. Is that correct? Can I say that? Do we all think the First Law trilogy is excellent?
Great. Fantastic.
Okay, great. So we all think that one's excellent. We're all Joe Abercrombie likers. I guess I'm the least. I've only read those and Best Served Cold, but I loved First Law. So I want to start with the characters because I think that's what Joe Abercrombie does best. He's really keying at that. So Monza, let's just start off with the main character. What do you guys think? Jimmy, you liked her?
Yeah, I love Monza. I think whenever I have a character's like motivations out in the open, whether or not they're on the nose is fine as long as it's executed properly. And I thought Monza's arc throughout the whole book was consistent, and I got behind her. I even kind of disliked her at some points. She's clearly flawed, like a lot of Joe's characters, but I like Monza.
On one hand, like of the point of views in this book, other than Shivers, Monza feels the most human to me. I get annoyed by how much of her success just seems to come down to complete luck and feel like totally unearned, and just everyone around basically handing it to her on a silver platter. Like, okay, we're talking about the first like scene. The guy has a push people off the cliff device, and I don't know, I guess Abercrombie point of view characters are like affected less by gravity, literally has the thing set up to kill people, and she just lives because, I don't know. Alan, you should not be watching this in the spoilers. Get out. That being said, I can't talk about her arc for the second half because I didn't get there. So she'd be in the middle of the pack for the best served cold characters and very near the bottom of the pack for first law characters in general.
I feel like a traitor to my sex that she's probably like, I don't know, I haven't ranked the characters in Best Served Cold, but she's by far like the least interesting to me because like I know what her deal is. I know the situation. She's like, she's the organizing catalyst for this to happen. And that's kind of all she is to me throughout the book. And like, she's written by Abercrombie, so she has layers because he's good at writing characters. But like, we know her deal. The deal is pretty straightforward. And so like, I was there to like see, I mean, I've often said that Shiver's character arc across all of the first law books is the best character arc in fiction, starting from like when you first meet him in Best Served, or before they are hanged through later to wherever he may or may not
be alive. And the most depressing. So far, the most depressing.
Oh, yeah.
It's first law. Were you expecting a happy character arc?
I could hope.
It could happen.
I agree, actually, Liene. This was really couched to me. Everyone was like, well, Best Served Cold has the female main character. You're going to love her. And she felt pretty flat. She felt pretty flat for me. My problem is that Joe is so good. I'm not on first name terms. Abercrombie is so good.
Lord Grimdark to you, peasants.
Lord Grimdark. He's so good at making characters suffer in a believable way. And so I felt like when she falls off this cliff and she's, you know, so crippled, I'm like, oh man, this is going to be so interesting. But then like, it didn't really seem to affect her that much. She's still an amazing fighter. And I felt like, well, that should have been a holdback for her. And then as we go through the book, we find out, oh, she wasn't really as ruthless as everyone thinks. It was actually her brother, which is something I see put on female characters a lot in dark fiction, that they are brutal, but oh, they're actually softies inside. And I just wanted to read about someone totally brutal.
Also, it's a bit much to call her people, a softie, though.
Also, the people who fight her, I mean, that's fight her left-handed, best 2 out of 3. So that makes it easier.
Yeah, it wasn't like it was bad. Like you said, he's always good at writing characters. It's not like she felt that flat, but I felt compared to like Shivers or Logan or Glockta, people who really were overcoming these things, I felt like he could have pushed her further.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's actually a pretty fair point. But I think if you take a look at, it's hard without saying spoilers. So when you look at the body of work that he's done,
you mean spoilers for later?
Yeah, so I won't, but over 9 books, when you look back at Best Served Cold, in my opinion, I feel like it's much more of a book about Call Shivers. Like, I actually feel like
I think of it as Shivers' book.
This is Shivers' book. Yeah. And Monza, even though she's like our main character, which is kind of past the side a little bit when you look at the whole thing, which I'm not saying that's a good thing or the correct thing to do. But I can see where you're coming from with that, because she almost ends up being the nuances can either fall flat for some people. That's totally valid. I guess what I'm saying is like, it's not as deep as some of the other characters that we see. Like, I think Shivers is much deeper. So I think that's a fair criticism of the book as itself, right? As it stands alone.
And I think part of it is that people just need to stop being like, that's Abercrombie's female book, because really it's, like, percentage wise, we don't actually hear from her that often, her perspective. Mm-hmm. And like you said, I think I felt much more connected to other characters than her. So it could have just been an advertising problem on my part. You know, I just got advertised it.
Yeah, that's a little weird, because the new trilogy, in my opinion,
I was going to say, like, Savine and
Savine.
We'll say her name, but.
Ooh, man.
Yeah, and it's the same. I also, I love Finry from the Heroes.
Yeah. Also Rikka in the new books, I feel like he gets forgotten. Fantastic. And Rikka is
guys, am I gonna be able to handle the new books? Is Best Served Cold the most brutal one? Because Best Served Cold almost killed me. It was so brutal.
I mean, I think The Age of Madness is arguably the least grimdark, in that it has a protagonist that's actually, it has a main character that I actually think is like, wow, you're not a terrible person. That could still change.
Don't ever say that. You jinxed it.
I was gonna say, like, you know, okay, can I say his name? It doesn't matter. Yeah, or so he's kind of useless, but like, He's not.
In my spoilery review for Trouble, this isn't spoilers, but I was like, because he is kind of, I don't think he's is a good character or a good person, but I was like, I probably identify most in the first law with Orso. And I feel like you're depicting this character really well, because I was like, that's how I am, and you're doing this correctly, because that's how I would be.
If you take the other first law characters and put them in this world, they'd be in prison. Orso would just be kind of a dick.
I mean, it's also like privilege. Like, he might be in prison. Who knows?
He'd be the least likely to be in prison.
So it seems like everyone loves Shivers the most, right?
Oh, by far.
Wait, what did you say?
Shivers. Everyone loves Shivers the most.
Mm-hmm. In Best of Cold, yeah.
In Best of Cold, yeah. No,
it's not Hannah? Even close. Is that like, wrong? When I was like,
no,
when
I thought she meant like, over all of the first law.
Oh, no. Just in Best of Colds.
Yeah, when I was contemplating DNFing and I was thinking about it, Shivers was the only thing that made it a question. Is it five POVs or six? Anyways, it was the only POV that I was like, I cared what happened to.
Did you stop before Shivers became transformed?
Oh, I got to that. So I stopped after the fight scene against the general with Monza, where like he fights her left-handed and then best two out of three, and then all the people who are super familiar with people dying are like, Gosuke has a 100% chance of dying, and I'm like, I'm pretty sure he's not gonna die. And I was like, are you really all leaving him? Like, you're all 100% sure?
I love Casca so much. I love Casca. After Shivers, I like Casca best in Best of Cults.
So Casca was probably my favorite, actually. I love Shivers' arc. His was my favorite arc. But I was very annoyed by Casca coming back from the dead. It's one of my least favorite things when characters clearly die and then they don't die. That bothered me. It really annoyed me.
I felt like it was a commentary. I give Abercrombie a huge pass on a lot of stuff. And Lost in Discoveries in chat, and he can agree to this, because he was not a fan in the First Law trilogy of the big magic scenes that happened at the end of the last Argument of Kings that kind of came out of nowhere. And I personally felt like that was a commentary on big magic battles in the finale of trilogies. Like, I thought it was a complete commentary, and he was making light of it. That's how I felt. I also feel that about Casca. I feel like he's that character. Maybe I'm giving him.
I also kind of feel like Casca is kind of like the Jack Sparrow of the First Law universe. He just shows up, says a bunch of like weird, hilarious stuff, is drunk 99% of the time. You thought he was dead. He's not dead.
Aren't we all?
Yeah. Shivers, I think, my one problem with Shivers, I felt like he was a little similar to Logan in terms of arc, a guy who wanted to be a better. In the end, they felt very different. So I'm going to give him credit for that. But at the beginning, that was like, oh, I feel like I've tread this water before. Yep. So I wonder if, Jake, if you felt that at all in the beginning, because you never finished it.
Yeah, I mean, he obviously starts to mirror Logan a little bit in that they both are trying to not kill people and are really bad at it. So, I mean, yeah, he's kind of, you know, Logan's getting a little... He's kind of like the new Logan-ish, but obviously, like, as a person, he's very different. It's his playing a similar role, though.
Mm-hmm. I also feel like it's what Jimmy was saying about it being a commentary on the fact that, you know, you sort of become what you despise. How, like, we meet Shivers in the First Law trilogy when he's this, like, kind of idealistic kid who's, like, even though it turns out he kind of hated his brother, like, his mission is to kill Logan because that's what you do. And then, like, he's, like, trying to be a better man, but he's, like, slowly basically turning into Logan, even though he was, like, trying to go a different way. But then you can see how, like, life just, when you choose Logan, you end Logan no matter what your intentions were.
Yeah, it's a revenge tale snuck into someone else's revenge tale. It's really interesting because one of the things that people dislike about First Law trilogy is the very circular nature of the narrative and how our characters generally do arrive back to where they began. I kind of refute that a little bit with Shivers. And to your point, like about it being kind of like Logan, I think this is where they differ. And obviously by the end, I think that the benchmark for Shivers is like here, and he's getting up here, and we start coming back down on the Ferris wheel, but then the Ferris wheel went through the earth. It went so much lower, and he is worse off. So it's not circular, right? It's very much an arc, and then a, you know, it's like GameStop stock just crashed. And I think that is, people might not like that, right? It's not the happy ending, but it is progress, for lack of a better term, right? It's movement.
It's changing.
One of my favorite things about the First Law trilogy was how every character almost ended up where they began. Mm-hmm. That was so brilliant to me, like that theme. Mm-hmm. And even seeing it here, I actually, of the things I liked about Best Served Cold, basically Monza starts in that castle, whatever, I can't remember the name, and then ends there. Mm-hmm. And where he Orso said she was going to end, right? And she denied it, got thrown off, and then she ends there. Like that was so brilliant. Like, mm-hmm. I have a lot of gripes with individual things that happen in the book, but his theming is spot on, in my opinion, in Best Served Cold. Like, when I got to the end, I still was like, wow, he had so much commentary and the themes are so strong. Like, he's so good at that. So for me, it wasn't like the themes were any less good. I just didn't really like how we got there necessarily sometimes, like the individual characters or scenes. I don't know if that makes sense.
No, I think that makes sense, actually.
How did you like the ending, Jake?
Oh, what I think of the ending? You know, no comment. I think it speaks for itself.
You think it really came full circle, really wrapped it up nice?
Yeah. I mean, I was going to say for like the U arc, that's probably why Before They Are Hanged is my favorite of the first trilogy. Because if you go for like the U arc for the characters, it's like, it's this part of the U.
Happy part?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's kind of, they start getting like towards progress. And then by the end, they're kind of retreating. They're running from the progress they made earlier in the book. And then they kind of just descend farther in Last Argument of Kings. And you're like, well, you tried. But one
Jake,
thing that
let's
does.
Talk. Why did you stop the book? Why don't you tell us that?
So
what made you stop
it? Yeah, what's your
here's
problem?
Something you guys talked about. And it was that how like Shivers and Logan are driven to be ruthless, right? One thing that annoys me is that Joe has consistently shown that when people are not ruthless, this world has driven them to be ruthless. So why the hell don't people just kill Monza? Like the guy, anyway, so I wasn't like super interested by the story. Like I started Best Served Cold. I obviously had sky high expectations. I was like, this is going to be great. And then I was kind of moderately interested and it was kind of like, you know, hovering at like, yeah, this book is fun. And then I got really mad in my headcanon of this book, which is why I did get to the end, is that guy in the scene that had like the statue fall on him. He just killed Monza. And so the book ended. Because he should have like 7 times. I want to know, like, isn't this world driving him to be ruthless as well? Like, does he not live in the same world as every other character who's driven to be ruthless? Like, why is he fighting someone left-handed best with it? And if it was like a duel and you're like, oh, he's just overconfident, that's one thing. The thing that makes it even more damning to me is his men are out there getting slaughtered. So he's like, you know, even if he's very confident that he can kill Monza, justifiably, like if the statue didn't fall on him, he would have easily killed Monza left-handed. He should be like, huh, my men are all out there dying. If I don't kill this Monza girl fast, I'm going to be fighting 1v19 and I'm going to die horribly. I don't live in this world, so I'm not ruthless. And it that pissed me off. In general, like Monza's success just getting down to like other people just not killing her when they could really annoys me, because they should live in, also be going through, have the same pressures that Shivers and Logan and almost every First Law point of view in the entire damn series do, to, you know, not monologue when you've beaten someone, right?
Yeah, that scene, that's so funny. That scene bothered me too, but for different reasons. I wasn't even thinking of it from that way. That whole scene, just like Casca pretending, like saying he was dead and then wasn't dead. And like, that was when I got most annoyed about her injuries. Like, how are you having this fight with this guy and you're still somehow okay and not just killed immediately?
So, also, for more, like, that's the scene that drove me from this isn't interesting me that much to just being mad at the book. And also, I had one of my rare, like, I had the day completely off to read Best Served Cold. And normally, when I have a day completely off, I can read a lot. And I was just not interested in it. I'd read like a page and I'm just like, whatever, check my phone. And I had like an entire day to read and I read like 110 pages. And I was like, I really just don't want to read this. And I'm angry at it. I'm going to pick up something else. I don't care what happens to anyone except Shivers. I asked in the Discord, I was like reacting to it. And I was like, does Shivers live through this? And people are like, I mean, I'm like, yeah, I'm DNFing. Just tell me, does Shivers live? And also Casca's totally alive, right? And they're like, yes, Glaska's alive. Yes, Shivers lives. I'm like, cool. We're moving on.
So for me, a lot of like, I give things like that. Some depends on how it's executed. So obviously it didn't bother me in this situation. It can. But a lot of, you know, war stories are told from the perspective of somebody who somehow made it. They probably shouldn't have. But like, that's the story you're telling. Like, you're not going to hear the story from somebody that died like everybody else. So like, for this to be Monza's story, like, yeah, she's going to make it through unlikely scrapes. And like, there are people who have like stories like that where like, they probably should have died 10 times over. And those are incredible stories. And that's why you're hearing about it. Because you're not going to hear about the guy that died like the first second they tried to do something. And then there are other characters that have also been like, been protected by plot armor. Glockta is protected by plot armor a lot. So like,
I think it's a weakness of Joe. He won't kill his characters, which is really weird in a grimdark. He protects his characters a lot. And I think sometimes I'd want to see a few more of them die.
At least Glockta has the pretense of like, everyone is just like, I can kill him whenever. He's a cripple. He can't walk. Monza is known as like very dangerous. Like, people try and kill Logan because Logan is terrifying. And one thing I really like about the different, like the contrast between the Logan Nine Fingers and the Bloody Nine is when Logan Nine Fingers is in a fight, he basically always plays the percentages. Like, if you go to literally any fight scene he's in and you like watch how he goes about the fight, he basically just plays the percentages 100% of the time. And yeah, he's eventually like, you know, even if you play the percentages in 100 battles, you know, comes up Snake Eyes. But that at least gives me a pretense where it's like, okay, this is why Logan lives. He's both a ruthless bastard. He's very large and strong. He's very fast and he plays the percentages. What does Monza have? Like, okay, yeah, you can be like, yeah, someone can just get through based on like luck and people not killing them. That can happen. I don't think it's that interesting of a book, but.
Also, for specifically that scene where that guy's fighting her and he chooses to do it left-handed, etc. I feel like, again, and like, you can disagree that it's done well or not, but it, to me, it almost feels like Joe Abercrombie is once again commenting on like, well, for one, people who act like arrogantly, foolishly so, usually get punished for it in his books. So this guy being arrogant and thinking he doesn't, you know, he can give her this advantage, and like the weird kind of like sexism of that, him being like, well, she's just a girl and like, I got this and I could just show off, and like being overconfident is almost always punished.
Well, I mean, even if he killed her, presumably, actually, how did the statue fall? I read this like a year ago. Would the statue still just fall on him? Like,
do you have an opinion about the statue scene?
It was already over it at that point. I was like, Koska's decapitating people with thrown knives. Statues are falling on people. Whatever. This is the world we live in now.
How did the statue fall? I don't remember now.
Christian could tell us. He just read it. He's in.
Yeah, that'd be good. Maybe like it was someone like hitting it from the other room or something from the fight going on.
It's been over a year since I've read it, but I didn't have any issues with the scene personally when I read it. One, I visualize every Abercrombie book like a Quentin Tarantino film. And if you've ever watched Quentin Tarantino's movies, everything is absurd. So like, I kind of expect absurdities here. One other thing, like, I don't necessarily agree with you, Jake, whenever you say that everyone in this world is really ruthless and they have to be, because I think when people think of First Law, they think of Logan, they think of Shivers, and they think of the North. But one like piece that, that's not getting kind of mentioned is the fact that we are in a different area. We're not in the North, and we're also not in England, right? Is that how you say it? I always forget the middle.
England.
Portion. Thank you, England. I'm uncultured. What did I tell you? So England, you have to remember, these are people who are brutes and they are, you know, devious, but they're pretending to be civilized, right? Where the North, that is how they live every day. Okay. And then we're in Styria. So these are different geographical locations, and there's a lot to say about the different kind of cultures throughout First Law. And I think that Joe has actually subtly built one of the best worlds in all of fantasy because of that. And the way that it has evolved over the 10 books, this is not a stagnant medieval, we're going to duel to the death society anymore. England and Styria are trying to get, you know, concrete rulers in place in governments so that this can move into a type of industrial revolution. And if you look at our world, it's very much like this. We are not still in the Wild West. We have progressed from that. And it's because of people dressing up in suits and pretending to be civil. So even Glotka having plot armor, that's part of the society. Like, that's society's pressure on our characters to not just kill people they want to kill. Because remember, he is a part of the state, for lack of a better term, right? He is in a position of power. And if that's not respected and that is kind of killed off, then the society that they've tried to build to move forward civilization in this world falls apart. So it's a reason why you see less and less violence in our everyday society. And I think that's what Joe was going for here. Again, maybe not executed correctly or whatever, but the statue scene didn't bother me. I don't remember how I got here.
In summation, the statue didn't bother me.
climate of all of the world in this Joe Abercrombie book, the statue didn't bother me. Jimmy reminded me, one thing that actually kind of bummed me out too about this book is how little magic there was actually. I wrote it down. I don't have my phone with me. It wasn't until page 354, I think it was, that an eater was mentioned. So we got through almost
I don't think I got half... to page 354, and I think I met the eater.
I remember thinking when I looked, it was halfway through. So that might have been under 300, but I wrote down the page number. I just don't have my phone. So an eater was mentioned, but before that moment, not a single magical thing happened. And I mean, that's fine. I get that it's in a fake world, I guess. But when I'm reading an adult fantasy, I was hoping for more of what we saw in the first law, and it was so much less that also bummed me out. Did anyone else notice that, or did no one just care?
Yeah,
don't really ever expect magic out of first law. So
you're gonna get used to that because magic is slowly draining out of the world in first law. So
yeah, and I know that.
Less magic. I mean, but the wizard became a banker.
I want to see it though. I want someone to talk about it. I want it to be a part of the plot, not like having to see it.
It becomes a more actively like discussed part of the plot in.
And I'm going back to what Jimmy said pre-statue. and it's I have two things. One, the best served cold fans are the people who specifically said that Shivers and like Logan Ninefingers, like a bunch of characters, have a character arc of being driven to be ruthless, and that the U arc of like most of the characters in the first trilogy was people becoming slightly less ruthless and then going back. Like, you know, Jizal tried to be a better person, ended up being a king. Like the world, I'm not saying everyone starts ruthless. Anyway, you know what I mean? Like everyone,
it's also different levels.
They don't all start like as ruthless or bad peoples, but in general, very consistently in the first law, irrespective of location, the world is driving the first law people.
So I would just, I have a semantic disagreement. I would say that I don't think the unifying factor is a move towards ruthlessness. I think it's a move towards cynicism. That characters start out perhaps having like some naive, like moral ideas, some beliefs in something, you know, so greater good. And by the end of the book or the trilogy or wherever, they tend to come away more cynical.
That's probably a better description. Yeah.
Yeah. That's and also fair. We have that context as a reader. So, you know, there's a lot of people who are very unaware of their position in the world and what it takes to get to where they want to be. So I think that's very realistic when you're in a character's head to
be realistic.
Yes.
About these things.
Jake, you need to be realistic. You read Wizard's First Rule all the way through. You DNF this book.
Yeah.
I love Wizard's First Rule. Stop talking about that terrible book.
I have a defense for that. And that's, I disliked Wizard's First Rule enough that I wanted to have a rant review of it, but I like Abercrombie. So I didn't really want to rant about Best Served Cold. I still tell people to read Best Served Cold because I know I'm an outlier. Also, I was listening to Wizard's First Rule on audio like 10 minutes a day because, you like Wizard's First Rule. Anyways, we're moving on.
We're not going to talk about that right now. That could be another later. Live.
Yes. To the magic point, I just want to say that I enjoy low fantasy, so I miss magic a lot in fantasy. Like, I'm not very good at picking up when it's missing from the world or the plot because I just typically do enjoy low fantasy. So, like, it just kind of shoots over my head. But I mean, I would agree. I think if you came into this hoping to get more of that, I could see how that'd be really disappointing.
Yeah, it wasn't disappointing. It was just something I noticed and we're not gonna talk about it yet. But I do find it strange that so many people try to compare Abercrombie and Sanderson so much because all the time on Reddit, everyone's trying to be like, who's better? And I'm like, they fill such different spaces in our fantasy genre that it's really strange to me that people are always trying to duke it out. Like, I'm not reading an Abercrombie book for the same reason I'm reading a Sanderson book. Like, they don't sit in the same realm.
Who's better, Frank Riordan or Stephen King?
Yeah.
I think
Abercrombie himself called them the yin and the yang of the fantasy genre, which implies like, you know, they're both very popular, but it's also, they're just so different. Like, they're kind of the opposite type of.
Yeah, it comes down to personal enjoyment of which one you prefer. Like I would read Abercrombie over Sanderson any day. But that doesn't mean that objectively
we're not getting there yet. We can't, yeah. Jim, we can't get there yet. I'm sorry. We can't. I'm sorry. We'll save that for the end because already. Anyway. I wanted to ask about actually Morvier. Is that how you say his name? Morvier the Poisoner, right?
I don't do audiobooks, so I say names wrong all the time.
You know, me neither. He was my favorite character. Favorite in the way I thought he was the most interesting character to me. I thought he was the newest character in this book.
I was going to say, nobody go over her house for dinner. Yes. Morvier, my favorite character.
No, favorite is the wrong word. Most interesting. Kind of like how people think Glockta is the most interesting. I thought he had the newest character to me because I did see so many similarities in Monza and Shivers and other characters. Like he, I felt like was actually like a different perspective, and I really enjoyed
him. The most different is Friendly. Let's be
real.
Well,
Friendly. Yeah. We just didn't see as much of him.
Yeah, Morvier. I thought whenever I read Morvier and Day, right, was the assistant. I think, right? Day, is that correct?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Day. Yeah, Day.
Yeah. So I would love if we had more of their backstory. Like, I could see, like, a short story collection of them being I think of Duncan Egg immediately from, like, A Song of Ice and Fire. But, like, seeing those two, like, being, like, their dynamic together was really interesting. Mm-hmm. And then just, I'd just like to see them existing in this terrible world. So I totally think that's valid. I think Morvier is very interesting. And I think probably the most original, Morvier hit more with me than Friendly, to be honest. I like Friendly, but my interest level in him stopped at a certain point. Whereas Morvier,
I wasn't trying to say I like Friendly better, just that if you want to go for the one who's most different, it's Friendly. Yeah,
Friendly was kind of weird for me because the first chapter of Friendly, I was like, wow, this is like such an interesting idea for the character. But I found like Friendly's got the thing where like he's obsessed with numbers and like being in prison more than not being in prison. And I was waiting for him to have aspects to his character other than that. And it's like every part of his voice is okay. He likes numbers a lot. And he really likes being in prison more than not being in prison. And I mean, obviously there might have been more, but
nope.
Oh, no, that's it?
Okay. I mean, that's what I liked about Morvier, actually, is his paranoia build, and we also see more of his arrogance, and more of his past comes out in his monologues, which ends up being very chilling. And I agree with you, Jimmy, that him and Day had just such a great dynamic. Yeah. I loved them so much. And I actually was pretty sad about how their arc ended. Like,
how did it end?
I'll tell you guys. Well, I'll tell you, Jake, and everyone listening. Just know I'm going to... basically Monza gets them to turn on each other through lying and they kill each other pretty much. I mean, not really. He kills Day and then Morvier dies later. Right? He dies at the end. Am I forgetting? He dies, right? For sure.
I mean, he's not alive in anything else. So I just assumed he was dead.
Alive, right?
For some reason, I feel like it was like unclear, but maybe I'm totally off on that.
I can't remember. That's just crazy. I just finished this book like a month ago and I can't remember, but I liked it. I thought Joe did a good job, like, cause I actually, even though they were unlikable people, I was like, oh, kind of sad that through lies, they end up having this fight. And it was sad. Totally agree. Lost in Discovery when he goes and he can't get back into jail, man. Somehow that was sad.
So I think for this does not apply as much for Shivers or Mon, but for like Morvier and Friendly, I found them weirdly gimmicky compared to like trilogy characters in that, like, obviously, for example, Logan Nine Fingers, he has his sayings and expressions and he has his gimmick. And that is he has an alternate personality that enjoys murdering people, but he has so much like personality and stuff outside of those gimmicks. And every First Law character ever, including in Best Served Cold, has an incredibly distinctive voice. Abercrombie may be the GOAT in modern fantasy at character voice. And this was the only book where, and those were the only two characters where I kind of felt like reading them, where I'm like, it didn't feel to me for those two characters like that was their voice because it's actually who they were as a person. I'm like, Abercrombie, are you just adding them saying this so they're distinctive? Like, can we please get... So I found them to be the least multifaceted characters Joe has written who have POVs. And
you're talking about Morvier and Friendly?
Yeah. In that they kind of
an answer
just...
to Morvir's fate. I don't know how we forgot this, but Casca kills him.
Yeah. Once they said that, I remember this thing so clearly.
Yeah, he poisons him with his own poison.
It's interesting you say that, Jake. I don't feel that way about Morvir. I do feel that way about Friendly, and to an extent, Day. I felt like it was a little overboard how much she was eating. Like, it felt a little bit into caricature territory, which Abercrombie rarely dips into. But I still liked their dynamic. I also found Besser Pool not to be as funny as First Law, which bummed me out, because when you're reading such a brutal book, it's kind of nice to have that dark humor.
Morvir and Casca always made me laugh.
Yes, we didn't get enough of them together. They were great.
I mean, for Day being a caricature, I feel like it didn't come across to me that way, because we're seeing her through Morvir's eyes all the time, and he's the one commenting on that. No one else's perspective is like, oh, she's eating again. It's only Morvir, who's clearly got like a thing about this, who is just like, oh, she's probably eating again. Like, what's your deal with that, sir? Calm down.
Oh, that's actually a super good point. That's a really good point.
I know an older gentleman like that. That every time
who poisons you?
No. Anytime someone's eating, it's why are you eating again? Like, it's like a thing. So,
well, if I don't eat, I will die.
This is true. I've heard that.
Yeah.
I've never tested it.
Yeah. Although, please don't. Anyway, we'll move on from the...
I found Shivers and Monza's romance scenes at times to be kind of...
Or the
comical.
Fake out romance scene where it's not actually them.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty comical. I mean,
I will say...
Besser Pool did make me laugh in the first 50%, so I thought humor was still...
That still wasn't enough for you to keep going.
It wasn't enough.
I was going to say, Jimmy, the one thing I will say, I'll say this. I have never thought a sex scene improved a book. I usually think they're just awkward and weird. I'm personally that way. I will have to say, Abercrombie is so good at just hilariously realistic, not trying to be sexy at all in any of his sex scenes. It's something I actually appreciate about him a ton, because a consequence of that is that none of them are objectifying to women, which is something I see a lot in sex scenes in books. And he just does such a good job of completely objectifying a man just as much, I guess you would say. Like, it's very...
I always like to say that the sex scenes are just as grim, darkly realistic as everything else. Like, they don't get a pass.
Yes, they don't. And I have to say, in this book, he excelled at that. Like, they were... funny.
People don't really talk about that as much, but I mean, like, the way that people like romanticize and idealize sex scenes, there is a bit of that in how people write violence sometimes, where they make it very heroic and noble and they just like keep going even though like you should be exhausted and you should be falling over. And Abercrombie's fight scenes are also that way, where like someone has tripped over something and they're like, oh fuck, and then they like hit themselves in the face with, like, they're like really like clumsy and realistic and like kind of painful. So like the sex is like that, the fights are like that.
So I think for Abercrombie fight scenes, I'll give you clumsy, not so much for realistic. This is one of my gripes, is people calling Abercrombie's fight scenes realistic.
As compared to other things.
I don't know. I mean, like, in terms of other things have magic, but like if you take the non-magical elements of a lot of other authors, I can't think of many thrown daggers decapitating people in any
book. That.
That was so stupid. Like, that was...
Jake, it was so stupid. I'm with you, because he also has people falling from extremely high heights and not being injured, and I cannot tell you guys how much it bothers me. I did a whole video segment on this, and I ranted on my Instagram, like, why is he obsessed with people falling from high heights and being like, I'm fine.
Gravity affects POV characters less in the First Law. Just accept it. Anyway, it's that it bothers me when people say, like, Abercrombie fight scenes are super realistic, because... they're not at all, right? Well, like, and it annoyed, like, it would probably annoy me. It would probably annoy me less if people didn't constantly praise his fight scenes for realism. And then I have a flash in my head of every scene where someone cuts through chainmail or decapitates someone with a dagger or anything dumb happens.
Yeah.
Or Monza takes her armor off because it won't offer any real protection.
All right,
come on.
I mean, I won't argue with that with this book, but I think you're doing that's a disservice to Joe Abercrombie and what he was able to accomplish in The Heroes and then further on into the later books, because whenever he has those war POVs where he jumps from people who are being affected by the wartime and their lives just end, and then you jump into the person that killed them, you cannot say that those aren't like literally some of the best written chapters in modern fantasy.
Yeah, so Abercrombie's extremely good at capturing the tone that like feels realistic. Yeah, but
even the movements in those chapters are very good. So you have to judge him by his whole body of work.
This was one of my flaws with the heroes. In the end, I didn't care for the heroes because it's like, all right, the heroes is not actually about, this isn't a spoiler, this is the premise for the book. The heroes isn't about who wins the battle. The heroes is about how war affects people. And that's the aspect that I think is extremely well done and realistic. The actual details of like military battles and are not particular. Like Abercrombie says he doesn't research these things. Like someone asked him like, oh, what research did you do for the fighting? He's like, I wrote what I thought sounded right. Like this is an R.F. Kuang who was doing a master's degree on the same topic as the book she's writing,
right,
for like the military battles. This is Abercrombie wrote what he thought is right. And like the tone and the feel and how it impacts the characters feels very real. But the actual like details are just not. Okay. He's good at making them feel real because he's good at writing.
Yeah, but I mean, maybe that's a fair point. And maybe I look for different things when it comes to combat. I guess what I'm saying is
like none of us has actually been on a medieval battlefield. So how is any of us going to judge whether or not this is realistic?
So, okay, here's a random example. In the heroes, there's like conscript cavalry. That's a thing that's in the heroes. And it's ridiculous. Horses were super expensive. Why would you ever do that? Like you would never do that in a real battle. Like it's dumb. It's like, hey, here's this super expensive.
Were they?
I don't know the actual number, but it's like, this was a thing for military. It's like, why would you take this horse that's super expensive to maintain, take this untrained person and put it on it? So
yeah, if they were on sale in Styria.
Well, then you would,
Jake, okay. Have you lived in England is what Jimmy's trying to say.
I have not lived in England, but I do know.
Best served cold. No, I'm just kidding.
I didn't. I have not been in England, but I do know that hasn't been a thing ever.
In fairness, like, I don't think when people are talking about how realistic it is, I don't think they mean like the having of horses or the not having of horses. I think they mean like hand to hand, a person to a person, the fact that they're getting like tripping over mud and the fact that like they accidentally like slice their own hand off or whatever, and that they like are trying to fight and then it's actually rain is in their eyes and they can't see, and like all of that stuff is more instead of just like magically fighting across the battlefield because I'm that good. Like it feels more realistic.
Yeah, so like the aspect of Abercrombie that makes his battles feel realistic in my opinion. So here's a random example. The other day while opening a thing for food for like that I ordered, it had a bag with a staple and I accidentally poked my finger with the staple. Ultra minor injury.
You turn into the bloody nine.
No, it was, but it was a pain in the ass for 2 days. So, and it's like Abercrombie, like that's the thing. If someone had like cuts their thumb, they're going to be like, my bloody thumb hurts and it's going to impact things. And that's the part that like makes it feel very realistic. But I die a little inside when people are like, oh, his combat, his military stuff is so realistic. Cause I'm like, is it though?
I think they mean on a it's personal gritty. Level.
Exactly. And that's the part where it's true.
Like no one's saying he's Bernard Cornwell. You know, I don't think that's what they're going.
Oh yeah, I guess there's also a difference between like strategy and being a tactician and just having like the in the scene feels like this person is like going through battle.
Yeah, I'll totally agree. It feels like obviously we haven't been in a military battle, but it feels like he's doing a good job of representing what it would be like to be in a completely chaotic battle better than the incredible majority of fantasy writers.
I really, really like what Lost Discovery said here. And he said the fact that we get scenes of people needing to pee because battle's what makes them like, so I do jiu-jitsu, and whenever I'm about to go on that for the competition, every single time I'm like, should have peed again. Like 100% of the time. Yeah. It's like, I might pee myself.
Okay, dog man.
I'm just saying.
I love that for dog man. Dog man needs to pee like literally every fight in the first Law trilogy. He's like, I should have pissed again.
Yeah.
I think that's a good point. I don't know about the realism of that. I'm a not fun person to watch movies with. I'm really over sensitive to physics. Like it just really bothered like physics problems. So I feel you, Jake. Like I do feel you there. I think probably people are talking about how they feel, the characters. I would agree with what Jimmy and Liana said.
Yeah.
I had a point and it left. I'm going to be honest. It just flew right out the window. I was going to add, but there it is. We'll just end.
Yeah. And it's part of the expectations I had because it was kind of pitched to me as like really realistic. So I was expecting everything to be really realistic. And I know like what people actually mean is like the tone and the feel of being in the person's head, not the details. But also the details bother me. And if you're going to and are realistic.
Yeah,
no, that's fair.
I was going to ask you guys about another thing I was curious about. I was wondering if one of the reasons Best Served Cold also has such a good reputation among Abercrombie's books is that it of the I've only read First Law, so keep that in mind. But it's so much more plotted. Like a lot of people complain against the First Law that it doesn't have a plot. And I actually really loved that about the First Law. Like it really drew me in, but I understand because people are right. The plot is very slow. And I wonder, like, do you think people like Best Served Cold more because like the plot is so clear and it goes through what it sets out to at the beginning? Do you think that's a part of it?
Yep. Yeah, probably. For sure.
100%.
Because it bored me. The end, I was getting really bored.
I feel like 100% that is the reason. And I think Sanderson fans who are trying to get into, like, I feel like this is their book. Like,
because me and Jake are huge Sanderson fans, yeah, so it's so funny you say that, and we both like First Law more.
My anecdotal evidence is Christian from Lost and Discovery, huge Sanderson fan, and I think that Joe, and he also liked the First Law trilogy, to be fair to him. But I'm just saying, I feel like there is so much plotting going on here that, like, if someone really hated the First Law trilogy because they're was no plot, which isn't true.
I agree.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. But if they want a really heavily plotted book, I mean, this is as tight as it gets for Joe. And
he sets it out. You know, there's six people. We're going to get revenge on them. It's a very clear.
Yes. And that worked. That, and I will actually agree with you. That was a detriment to me. I could just, Glocka could be going to the post office. That's all I need. I don't necessarily need everything to be, packed tight.
I actually didn't prefer it. Like, that's actually something that bored me about the book. I felt like it was so predictable because we knew we were going to get all six people. I actually weirdly came to love how the First Law was so unexpected because you just never knew where the journey was taking you. It was just.
I always cringe a little. Like, I always, on the inside, when people say start with Best Served Cold, because it scares me, because if I had started with Best Served Cold, I probably would have only read one Abercrombie book.
I just also think
and that, I would have missed out on a lot of books I love.
I don't approve of reading it outside of publication order.
That too. Stop skipping books, people. Don't skip live ship either. Totally unrelated, but don't skip live ship.
But it's just also because in particular, because a lot of what impresses you, if you're going to be impressed, is the way that a lot of little things get woven in that you don't have to know them, but that is the richness of the tapestry that he's weaving. And otherwise it's just the plot. And then there's a lot of this little stuff where he'll just mention something else that you oh, that's from the trilogy, or that's from this other book. And I know who that is. And I know what that is. And just even going back and reading the trilogy, when they briefly mention the Snake of Talons, now that if you're going back to reread, you're that's Monza. I know who that is. And in these books, anytime someone's oh, the cripple, you're Glockta. But if you're just reading First or Cold first, you're okay, cool, whatever.
That's actually one of my favorite things about Best Served Cold, honestly, was the mentions of other people, particularly everyone fearing the cripple and saying he's running the show when we really know what's happening. So I love having that extra knowledge. It's one of the things that's convincing me that maybe even though it's brutal, I should try more Best Served Cold because I love how interconnected, those players are.
We're basically the Leonardo DiCaprio pointing meme for half the scenes and where it's the cripple. Oh, yeah.
But also I feel to the point of Best Served Cold being more tightly plotted. I feel the pendulum swung way far the other way. The First Law trilogy is so meandering. And if you love that, you love it. But it can put people off. And especially if you've never read it before, then you're is this going to eventually have a point, though? At any point, will it have a point? And it does. But you don't know that the first time you're reading it. So if you can be kind of this is cool and all, but where are we going? And then Best Served Cold is so tight, so nonstop. We're killing people, killing people, killing people, the end. And then I feel the new trilogy, he's finally melded the two, where he's got something where it feels tightly plotted, where you don't feel like it's meandering, but it's not this intensely fast-paced thing like Best Served Cold.
I think the plotting for Age of Madness is outstanding.
It's his best.
It's his best yet.
I agree. Now, almost in every. I mean, I guess it's the lowest magic, But other than that, it's so good. I don't expect much.
I don't know what's going on in Trouble with Peace. There's magic.
Kind of. Yeah, it might not be. I don't know. They're all pretty low magic. Whatever. It's kind of the point of Abercrombie is that when you're a character who sees magic, it's terrifying because it's not at all a normal part of their life.
And when other people bring it up to other people who haven't seen it, they're like, magic. Ha! And they're like,
Thing I loved, how more of you did not believe there was magic in this world. Like, I love that. So it's not like I need more magic. I just want to see, seeing it discussed. Like, I love that part so much.
It'd be funny if it ended with Baez exploding Morvir. That'd be pretty funny.
Baez.
Yeah, I think Joe could have got more out of the fact that there is a lack of magic through those conversations. Mm-hmm. I think that's an extraordinarily good point that not a lot of people talk about, is that you can actually use the lack of magic to be interesting, right? Like, that can help build the importance of magic. Mm-hmm. It's something that A Song of Ice and Fire does extraordinarily well, actually. Yeah.
I was also going to say, for best of cold, I tend to be the person who's more of a fan of the more, I'll say, indulgent books when it comes to plotting. Like, a lot of the time when people are like, oh, that should have been 200 pages shorter, I'm like, I probably would have liked it less though if it was 200 pages shorter. So when we get to best of cold, which is kind of the more tight one, that's, I'm generally more of a fan of the books that kind of are like, what I'm like, yeah, whatever, take however many pages you want.
Yeah,
you indulge book.
I felt like 1200 pages so on the nose about what it was, which is fine.
No, get out, Alan. Someone get Alan out of here.
He's allowed to be here. If he wants to spoil everything, it's fine. No. Jimmy, go ahead. It's fine. Just spoil it all.
Yeah, so I feel like with Best Surf Colby, I just wanted to know what happened at the ending. And the middle failed to grab me as much as I was grabbed in, like, you know, before they are hanged. The only thing that really kept me super interested was Shivers. That was what kept me. And then I love I like the ending of this book a lot. And it felt like a worthy journey. It just didn't. In fact, this is a super unpopular opinion. But I think Red Country is actually the best standalone book. And I know people hate Red Country for whatever.
I don't hate it.
A lot of people give me flack for that, but I think Red Country is almost not a better version of Best Served Cold, but there's a lot of similarities, like the fact that the plot is going a place that you know it's going, and I think he did a better job in it personally. But
yeah, I think a lot of people don't like Red Country just because the protagonist, Shy, is not exactly... I've never seen someone say Shy is their favorite Abercrombie character, let's put it that way.
Yeah, I know that Abercrombie himself said that he felt the most burnt out when he was writing Red Country. And to me,
really?
I think, well, one, I do think that does come through, but also to me, that's not a detriment to it, because me personally, I tend to think of Westerns as feeling kind of burnt out. Like, I feel like when I picture like a Western, it's just like you're out there on your own in the desert. I feel burnt out just thinking about it. So like feeling burnt out writing a Western, I'm like, well, that goes with the territory. So
yeah, I actually agree with that.
By the way, to Arvija, I think the heroes, even though it's set in a battle, it's not about the battle, which is why I really like the heroes. Like, it's a battle, but it's not like, you know, it's a battle for the fate of the world. The result of the battle doesn't matter, which they're fighting over a hill. Like, come on.
Well, okay, I don't mean the result of, like, the territory, but the result of the, like, what happens because of the battle.
Yeah, so definitely. I think, like, in general, Abercrombie stories... Like, the first law isn't a story about, like, the quest. It's the story of how, like, the quest you'd see in fantasy would affect the people in the quest. And it's the same thing. Like, it's not really about the battle. And that's why, like, none of the POVs are, like, the general. Because that's not what the story is about. It's about how the war impacts people in different ways. So I really like the heroes. And I think even though it is about a 3-day battle... Even if you're not a huge fan of battles, I think you really could too, because the character work and development is really fantastic.
Even though it's totally unrealistic and like none of this is actually possible, and like Abercrombie is like the worst at writing battle, but you should read it.
I didn't say he's the worst at writing battles. I said people who say, I get sick of people saying he's super realistic.
Back to the plotting real quick before we see lasers. I was gonna say the ironic thing is that I think the lack of plotting in First Law is what kept me not being able to put it down, because I was so like, what's gonna happen? Whereas I felt the end of the book, I was like, well, she's just going to go kill Orso or try. She's just going to go do this. I started dragging because I just felt like I already knew where it was going. And so I don't know. It's weird how that is. I feel like in a normal book, I wouldn't like that. But the way Abercrombie writes, I think it's more interesting when he leaves things open. I don't know.
I didn't really care what Monzo would do. I was there for Shivers, and I continued to be interested in Shivers.
Yeah. I'm kind of strangely like that with television and movies. It's really hard for me to sell out for like a 2-hour movie, but I'll watch 10 episodes of a TV show where I get to get all these intimate scenes that sometimes don't even matter. Mm-hmm. But yeah. Television, like, usually know what's happening in the first 20 minutes of where it's going to go, unless if it's like a spectacular movie. And I'm just like, nah, I'm all right. Like, let's just get through this. Like, I'll turn movies off so fast.
Unless it's Lord of the Rings.
Yes, well, exactly.
Of course.
I think
we're not crazy. We may disagree about Best Served Cold, but you're not allowed on my lives if you're going to.
Wait, 2-hour movie? No, 4-hour movie? Exactly.
I'm in. 3 4-hour movies. I think if you look at my movie time watched over the last 2 years, it's like 80% Lord of the Rings, 20% everything else. I don't watch that many movies.
Go to the cinema, rewatch Lord of the Rings.
No, that's not even a. There's no weighing there.
But I definitely agree. Like, I kind of just like existing in the world with these characters and like what's going to happen. Like, Glock is going to have something terrible happen to him. We all know it, you know, or he's going to do something terrible to someone else. And I'm just waiting for that next scene while also learning all this stuff about the character that I'm so invested in. Something Robin Hobb also does very, very well. Yeah. I actually think. I've been saying this for like a couple weeks now, but I think Robin Hobb and Joe Abercrombie have a lot more in common.
I said that in my Royal Assassin review, or at least I said it to my reading buddy, where I was like, it's actually really quite grimdark, almost like on an Abercrombie level. And like, there's a lot of character introspection. It's just the fact that your POV character is Fitz. That's not very Abercrombie, but like everything else.
I agree.
I think the aspect of Cher, you know how like you said for Abercrombie, we mentioned that's like, you know, if you stub your toe, that isn't, or like break your toe, that isn't a mild inconvenience. That, you know, hurts like hell. It's the same thing in Robin Hobb, where it's like the tone kind of like feels like grounded realism, where like the normal things that impact people's lives still have impact, with the difference being that. So it's like they've got similar tone in that respect, but obviously like Fitz would not be a protagonist in the first one.
Well, again, I think the plot of like Royal Assassin or something, like if it was just told from the perspective of Regal, it could be an Abercrombie book, but because it's told from Fitz's perspective, then it's a Hobb book.
Anyway, yeah, I think one question that could be interesting, it's not really about Best Served Cold, but a lot of people say that Abercrombie is the most realistic writer. And I think that's very interesting because I don't really prescribe that our world is that depressing. I guess I'm more of an optimist, but I feel like it is his way of making sure that everything you do does have a consequence that feels so realistic about his books. Like you guys were saying about, you know, if someone gets a paper cut in a Robin Hobb book or an Abercrombie book, it means something. And there's so few authors that really take every single thread and have them still mean. Like, does that, what I'm saying, make sense? Like, I mean, he really just never lets anything drop. And I think that's where the realism comes in.
Also for like a Royal Assassin by like Regal could be an Abercrombie book. I forget what Discord it is on, but a while ago we had a big of who would the POVs be if Abercrombie wrote Way of Kings. We settled on like Sadeas, Elokar, a random Parshendi archer, and Zeth.
Not dark enough for an Abercrombie.
I don't know, the random Parshendi archer for shooting people.
Might be, for sure.
Anyway.
Also, well, we've already been on for like an hour. Should we tackle the question? Way of Kings. What was the question?
No, we're going to.
What was the question? Let's like first law compared to the Way of Kings. That's the question. First law compared to the Way of Kings. Let's all take a round. Jimmy, why don't you start us off?
Well, it's no surprise. I would rather read Abercrombie. He's just more my style. I like his writing more. I actually like, I also, and this is kind of aside, but like, I just feel like Abercrombie's prose is criminally underrated. Like people just act like he's super blunt, but there's a magic in being efficient with your sentence structure.
He's the wordsmith.
He does it. Yeah, he does it. And he's also very truthful with his readers. It's something that he talks about in one of his interviews with Daniel Green, actually. He was talking about how his mom told him to never lie to the reader. And I appreciate that a lot with his prose. So I identify more with Abercrombie's view of the world. As I'm not an optimist. I am very, very much pessimist.
You have to be realistic.
Yes, and that just happens to be a very cloudy, you know, gloomy way of looking at things that I have. But overall, I just always end up feeling a little bit more satisfied when I finish a Joe Abercrombie book rather than a you know, the Way of Kings, but they're totally different. They're totally different. And on a different day, I might say Way of Kings. But for me, First Law gets a lot more mileage for me because I feel like I end up leaving those books with like nuggets of truth or a quote or something that means a lot to me. So,
okay. So we got First Law one. I want to, before you go, Jake, I want to say, let's compare First Law to Stormlight Archive. I don't think it's fair to say, like, a whole trilogy to the first book. So let's do it as trilogy to archive. Sure. Okay. Jake, take it off.
I was going to first say for prose, I totally agree with Jimmy. And I think I'm going to say the reasoning why before I say why I like Stormlight more. I like Stormlight more. And it's that a lot of the people with like really beautiful writing, for example, I just read Guy Gavriel Kay, they set the scene and it's like, it's super beautiful the way they set the scene. Abercrombie sets the scene equally vividly, but it's vivid how terrible it is. Like, you know, it's vivid that everyone's boots are like stuck in the mud and smells like shit because they accidentally shit in the wrong spot. So I agree, it's vivid. It's just, it's not seen as beautiful because the things he's describing are not nice. Anyway, that being said, I like, shocking everyone, I like Stormlight more. I'm, even though I don't dislike Grimdark, Grimdark's just not my favorite genre. I think both are pretty much equally good executions of what they're trying to be. I like what Stormlight's trying to be more. You can call me corny, but basically all my favorite characters are mostly good guys. The top bad guy is probably below 10th. So I kind of like Stormlight more by default. I also really like really weird worlds that aren't Earth-like. Stormlight. So it's not super close for me just because Sanderson's writing more of what I want to do.
Okay, Liana, we got 1-1.
I wonder what...
cut myself with a knife today, so don't mind like my 2-year-old Band-Aid here. Sorry.
It's probably going to inconvenience you quite a bit if you end up in a battle.
Well, obviously, First Law. I do think, though, like, because I'm on record as loathing and despising Way of Kings, but I did like Mistborn Trilogy. So, like, I think it's more fair if I, like, do that. Because, like, I haven't hated everything I've read of C. Anderson. I really liked The Final Empire, and I gave 5 stars to The Will of Ascension. So, C. Anderson, I don't think is as good as Abercrombie, obviously. And I do think Abercrombie's prose is very artful. And it's not just in how vividly he describes things. He finds, without being purple and absurdly metaphorical, he finds very clever ways and very like interesting ways of like communicating something to the reader or about a character. Like the way that a character will think of something, it'll be in this like weird twist of language that like puts it in a bizarre perspective that you wouldn't have thought of. And yeah, he doesn't get enough credit for that because they're like, oh, it's like grimdark and battles and people are awful. And like, I mean, I say that too, but there's a lot of art to what he does.
Yeah, so we're 2-1. So I don't think I would have a problem if people were trying to explain, like, say, okay, let me start over. Abercrombie is definitely better at prose. Like, I just don't think there's any denying it. And his character voicing is unparalleled. And I read a lot. Okay, we all read a lot. Like, it's just really, really good. I'm going to be another Stormlight Archive. So we'll end 2-2, which I think is very good. The reasoning I think is a lot for what Jake said. One is I've always been a high fantasy gal. Like from very, very, very young, I've always read very high fantasy things. And, you know, Joe Abercrombie is just low fantasy. It's just, it sits in a different space. And I'm always kind of about that stuff. And I also am the person who likes to read about hope. And when I end an Abercrombie book, I feel pretty sad inside. And it feels pretty dang dark. And when you're hearing shivers go from this like, I'm going to be a good guy to this, to this eyeball ripped, burned out of his skull, depressed. Like, I feel down.
And when
I find Glockta's internal monologue when he's talking to his bosses so cathartic and uplifting. So I'm like, yeah, that's how it be, man.
I mean, yeah, it's funny, but ultimately, like, the hope I feel out of the Stormlight Archive, even though I understand it has not prose as well, or the themes aren't maybe as deep. You know, one thing I'll say about Abercrombie is, especially with the First Law, it really stuck with me. Like, I kept thinking about it after I was done and kind of understanding more and more of the themes. And I think that's a very, very literary thing that he does. But ultimately, when I finish a Stormlight Archive book, I feel good inside and I feel happy. And that is what I like to feel. So Bookborn is based off of Mistborn. I don't think there's any shockers that I am choosing a Sanderson, you know?
But based on my avatar, right? Like,
right. But I will say, as someone who was really scared to go into Grimdark, and Abercrombie was my first Grimdark, it really did blow me out of the water. I was not expecting to like First Law, so I understand.
Why it's all downhill from here, though, because he's the best at it, so.
Anyway, I also...
won't read any more Grimdark. I'm fine with that. Right.
I should say, for why I like Stormlight more, I think Abercrombie's characters are always fantastic. Obviously, I find if you put characters on the scale of how interesting they are and how invested I am in them, I don't get nearly as invested in Abercrombie characters. Like, the First Law didn't make me come close to crying. Like, when Abercrombie kills a character, I'm like, that sucks. When Sanderson kills a character, I'm like
Rudd 3G didn't get you teared up.
I was like, that sucks.
It's Jake. It's interesting you say that. And it's Jimmy. It's not because I don't care about the characters. It's because I went into Grimdark knowing people were going to die. And so that expectation puts me on guard. So I'm at this guarded place where I'm like, I can't care about these characters because they're all going to die and have awful lives. Where when I go into a Stormlight book, it's not Grimdark. So you're like, well, hopefully they can survive. And so when someone dies, it hits me more. So I think it's an attitude. And I think if you have that attitude...
P.S. Hob is both 10 for interest and investment for characters, so there we go. Well, anyway.
So you're saying that actually it's not Abercrombie versus Sanderson because Hob is the queen. And is
Hob is the underrated queen. That's what you can take from this.
Sure. I mean, it's kind of like there's things they're all better at. Like, it's like, obviously, Abercrombie's better at prose than Sanderson. Not Hob, in my opinion, but better than Sanderson. It's also like, you know, if you're like, which world building is better? First Law or Stormlight? Like, obviously it's Stormlight. They're obviously better at different things.
I think it's hard to compare world building. So I think Jimmy's laughing because he thinks First Law is better. But the problem is it's really hard to compare low fantasy to high fantasy. The amount of the different work that goes into creating a realistic setting like Abercrombie's, which feels like a real world in a different place versus Way of Kings, which has so much effort in how the Cosmere works together. That's why when you're talking about yin and yang, I mean, it is hard to compare them, in my opinion.
Well, I mean,
I go to them for different things.
I was gonna say, it's also like, it's a matter of like what, it's clear what you as a reader and also what the author is interested in. And so like there, a lot of it is like if their interests align with yours. And I've just found that apart from a few exceptions, Sanderson's interests don't align with mine. And so the parts that he's focusing on, that he's interested in exploring, are the parts that I care the least about. And the parts that I care most about, he's not giving time and attention to. Whereas Abercrombie is giving time and attention to the parts that I care about. And yeah, like,
that's why I get liking Mistborn more than Stormlight, even though I think in terms of like character world building and prose, Stormlight is better. Because it's like Stormlight is the most Sanderson book, where it's kind of like, you know, when he was going to get published, he was like, you know what? People wanted him to write like George R. They basically wanted him to write Abercrombie like stuff, and he's not good at writing Abercrombie stuff, and he's like, you know what, screw him, 3 prologues, crazy world, we're gonna do all this weird shit, and you know what, some people aren't gonna care about it. So it's why, even though I like Stormlight vastly more than Mistborn, I kind of get why people do like Mistborn more than Stormlight, because if you're not a huge fan of the style of stories Sanderson says, Mistborn doesn't lean as hard into that style.
I'm gonna take a little hit on this one though. Joe Abercrombie's books are really long, so let's not pretend that Abercrombie doesn't take hundreds of pages to tell a story. Did you guys read the First Law trilogy? Like, come on. So I don't want to hear that. I mean, just saying, like, when you read a Sanderson book, it's so fast paced, like versus Abercrombie, which is like a different pacing. So I feel like it's hard to compare just length of pages. You can read a 1,000 page, like I read a 300 page book that I felt like 10 times longer than a Sanderson book because of the pacing. So I feel like it's hard to compare page count as like a way to tell a well-written story.
Yeah. I mean, also Stormlight has like 7 times more point of views than First Law.
To be fair, Abercrombie really trims it down in the new trilogy, which is his best
work. He does. Oh, it's so tight.
He trims it down quite a bit.
It's perfect.
I mean, I'm fine. I'm the one who said that Rhythm of War needed like 200 more pages.
Oh,
so
no.
You don't want to talk to me about
this. I like Rhythm
Brent
of War.
In chat is killing me. He's
Rhythm of War, there was a plot line in there that was very rushed. And so that's all I'm saying, okay? Anyway. Jimmy's not going to be my friend anymore after this live.
Brent in the chat is just killing me. Like, yeah, I mean, look straight.
So I love Rhythm of War, but Brent's roasts of Rhythm of War are hilarious very consistently. Full credit.
I have a feeling me and him feel very similar to on the book.
It's also similarly. So there's
also, I'm the only one here that didn't like Mistborn, right?
I guess.
Well, I think Warbreaker is the best one that book, I did. Like. Nobody agrees, so it's fine. I think Warbreaker is his best work. So
I could see that more than Mist. I didn't like Mistborn.
I think Mistborn's the most tightly plotted. Like Stormlight isn't fast paced. Like Stormlight is more indulgent on the plotting. Like it's kind of like Way of Kings. It meanders a lot. Like it's like, you know, the plot, you don't even really know what Kaladin's plot is until like, you know, 200 pages in.
That's true.
We're going to get there. We're not taking the path. We're going through the forest. We're going to check out this tree over there. We'll get there.
The thing I think about Abercrombie and Brandon Sanderson is I think it comes so much down to just like Liene said, what interests you. But I think for me, I think they're both amazing at what they do. I think Abercrombie and Sanderson are both top tier and I think they both deserve it. And I think that, cause like my husband actually didn't really like the First Law trilogy. And so I went into it he's a huge Sanderson fan. I am too. He thought it was fine. He thinks it's overrated. I read it and didn't think it was overrated at all. But I think it's interesting because I have a lot wider reading range than he does. And so I think that's why for me, it's like,
burn right there.
What's a burn? No, he would say that. Oh, he would say that for sure. If he was in this room, he'd be like, yeah, you read way wider than I do. Like he has a very specific thing he likes. And I don't think that's bad. And so I guess I get frustrated when people on Reddit are having this duke it out between Sanderson and Abercrombie, like there's some right answer.
There is no right answer.
Yeah, also, we're going to start another weird tangent here because I find overrated somewhat weird for books because of how subjective they are. Like, it's overrated if you felt all these emotions while reading this book. Like, what? I don't get it. Like, everyone can acknowledge that, like, the enjoyment of a book is completely subjective.
Are
you lying about how much you enjoyed it?
I don't think Versus is, like, all that interesting of a con. Like, I see people do it a lot.
Interesting, or it stuck out to me that earlier you said that physics is a thing that really like that you zero in on, because like for the first time after like 2 years of the mob like attacking me for not liking Way of Kings and me trying to find somebody who's reasonable to explain to me what I don't get, like clearly everyone loves this, explain to me why you love this without murdering me. They always jump to murder. So finally it was explained to me, and it was to do with physics, because Angela from Literature Science Alliance, she's a big fan, and she was going on and on and on and on telling me about all of the ways there's like actually quantum mechanics.
If you haven't seen her video about quantum mechanics in Way of Kings or just the Stormlight, I highly recommend. It's an amazing video.
And like she and I basically ended up with like a First Law versus Sanderson debate, because like she was like, I study physics and I'm into this. And I was like, I studied anthropology. I'm like, I'm into Abercrombie. So like, I'm never going to be into quantum mechanics in a magic system. I give precisely this many shots about that.
No, you know, Liene, that's so good. I was an engineer major. Okay. So I was an engineer major, and I really wonder anthropology versus like science engineering, like such a different mindset.
And
like,
my dad's an engineer, and he loves Sanderson. He's read every like Sanderson book.
I mean, physics is a bonus for me. I'll take it. It's cool.
Yeah, I studied physics in college, and I in my review of Way of Kings, I really like Way of Kings. I love Way of Kings. That was one of the things I mentioned. I said, man, sprint seemed like a big deal. There's a lot of wave particle behavior here. I really like that. And then in book four, we got like an encyclopedia about it. And I was like, oh, I'm done.
And that was when I was like, I need more of this.
Yeah, that's anyway. Where. Yeah.
Anyway, I think like, what was it? Where was I going with this? I just forgot. Anyway, someone else can say something. I'll go back to earlier. And that's Jimmy said, I could read Glockta reading about going to a post office. And I just wanted to say, I totally agree. And whenever I'm thinking about like who my favorite character is, there's kind of two measures. Like how much did I enjoy their chapters? And also like, could I read about them doing nothing? Because there's some characters that I could read an entire book of, you know, this character lives a normal week in their life, and I'd be like, this is fantastic. And Glockta is one of those.
I think if you're going to read a week in a normal life of anybody, Abercrombie's the one I want to write it. Like, if that's the rule of any character, yeah, he's...
Hob.
Oh, Rob. I'm talking about... We're talking about Sanderson versus thing. Yeah, between them. No one can beat him. I think you said he's goat at character voice, and he really is.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, Thanks, guys. Do we all like each other still?
Yeah.
I'm still alive.
So. We're only going to fight a little. I mean, I was the person coming at risk as the guy who DNF'd it, I think. So.
Yes, but then we moved into talking about Way of Kings, and that's danger zone.
I wonder, it's kind of interesting. I actually don't think we hard disagreed on a lot about Best Served Cold. I think it actually came down more to things that you forgave and didn't notice versus things you did notice. Like, I don't actually feel like my opinions were that different. Even though I only thought it was okay. So,
just focus on Shivers. That's the key.
Shivers is great.
Yeah, Shivers.
Yeah, and I think so that's interesting.
When I say like I only DNF'd this because it was a standalone. I've read, and because I didn't want to read something bad by Abercrombie because I like him so much and it hurts more. It's like if I'm reading an author for the first time and I don't like them, it doesn't hurt as much as being like, you wrote the trilogy and I like it so much. But like when I look at like my scale of like books, this was like, if you just ask me, did you like it? Yes or no? The answer is no. And then I add a bunch of asterisks, like the dialogue's really good. It's really well written. Shivers is great. So it's like the opposite. If I give a book,
the
like
best worst book you've read.
Well, yeah, I mean, Jake, you put Abercrombie on a different scale, and that's what's always hard. It's like, you know, because he is on a different scale, you know?
I don't even know if I do. I actually just didn't enjoy reading it compared to even compared to authors who I think are technically much worse, which is most. So, I mean, technically he's fantastic. I mean, I think I said, if you go to my Goodreads review, I ended it with like, this was a technically really well-written novel that just didn't work for me at all. And it's like, I think the fact that I still tell people to read Best Served Cold kind of shows in that. Like when people are like, they finished the trilogy, I don't go like, oh, skip to the heroes. I'm like, no, I'll read Best Served Cold. You'll probably like it.
There's because also you can't like, that's where Shivers happens.
Yeah.
So like you can't miss that.
Yeah. And I mean, Shivers, I feel like getting to the part I got to is actually pretty important for Shivers.
I was gonna say, like, if you went from Last Argument of Kings to like A Little Hatred and never read anything in between, you'd be like, Shivers, what?
Yeah, and I mean, even if you skip,
it happened to my boy.
I think almost any skipping of a standalone book will confuse you.
Yeah, if you skip to the heroes.
Yeah, if you skip to the heroes, you'll be confused. If you skip the heroes, you'll be confused. And then if you skip Red Country, it's Shivers is great.
Any of them.
Yeah, I think Best of Cold is a brutal book. It makes you sad inside. It is well written. For me, it wasn't.
I didn't care about anyone, except Shivers.
Yeah, well,
you started sad inside.
I don't care about people to read a scene where someone is getting their eye burned out. I don't care if you don't care about them or not. That is just unpleasant.
That was harsh. Yeah, that was harsh. But I think earlier this year, I was reading Tawny Man and the Poppy War at the same time. And it was a fantastic example to me of why adding to the body count is not more emotional. Like, in terms of body count, Poppy War is overwhelmingly higher than Tawny Man. Like, it's not even close. But in terms of how actually sad it made me, Tawny Man is overwhelmingly more emotional, and it's not even close.
I'd say the part that in First Law that's made me most emotional was probably when Glockta sat down with West in the Blade itself and was like, you know, you weren't even my friend, and you, and West was like, no, didn't your mom tell you? Like, I came to visit you, and you're like,
that was a good one.
You're friends.
I just like the First Law, guys. I just, Best Served Cold comparatively, every time someone talks about Best Served Law or the First Law, I'm like, oh yeah, that book was good.
I felt like it was a step down from the trilogy. I'm with you on that.
I like trilogy Abercrombie the most by quite a lot, even though I like the other standalones.
What about the new trilogy?
Oh, the new trilogy's the best.
You like that the most?
Yeah, so trilogy Abercrombie as in Abercrombie in trilogy,
in the structure of a trilogy.
Yeah, like Abercrombie when he's writing a trilogy. By Lost and Discovery, we'll miss you.
We're gonna end soon anyway because we've been going a long time. We're still friends. I feel like it's good. Thank you guys so much for joining me about Best Served Cold. Hopefully we change some people's minds. I don't know. I feel like maybe you guys, Jimmy and Liene, made me feel differently about some of the themes. Like maybe I'll forgive a little bit more because I feel like you guys convinced me to feel about the themes. You know,
it's always very hard to change someone's mind on a. But I think the only thing you can really change someone's mind on is if someone thinks something is a plot hole and then you explain it and it's like, it's not a plot hole. Because it's like, you could explain, like, someone could write an essay about like how great a character arc other than Shivers and Best Served Cold is, and it's not going to change that the emotions I felt while reading Best Served Cold, right? And it's like, it's the same thing for Liene for Way of Kings. Like, someone could make a presentation about why it's great, and she's still going to be like, but I was bored.
After the first time I read The Heroes before I reread it, because I did like it a lot better rereading it, and I liked Master of Cold a little bit less. But keep after reading The Heroes, like learning more about kind of what his intention behind writing it was, which was, you know, the whole like, you know, All Quiet on the Western Front, basically, where it's just going to be battle. And that is all we're doing here. And this isn't meant to be like a plot arc like Master of Cold. It's just to do this project of writing war. And so like even learning that about it after having read it, I retroactively was like, I mean, yeah, if that's what it was trying to do, it did that very, very well. I was just expecting a plot.
Actually, The Heroes is, I like it less than the trilogies, but I think it's thematically his most interesting thing that he's written.
As a project, I was like, I respect it certainly a lot more now.
It's also almost all of the reasons why I don't like The Heroes as much as, say, A Little Hatred, are not due to execution. It's just due to the structure of The Heroes makes it implicitly harder to be compelling for the entire story, right? Like, anyway, A Little Hatred is so good, by the way.
Well, we'll see if I read more. I'm a little nervous to read a book about a 3-day battle, since the battle scenes were my least favorite parts in the first.
It's about the character. It's about how it affects the characters, not the really. That's what it's really about.
They invent the cheese sandwich. Battles?
They do. That is
the cheese, you know, strap.
Jimmy Nuts, in one of his Talking to Nuts, talked about Abercrombie's like evolution of technology, and he did not mention the invention of the sandwich. So I'm calling
the
you
cheese
out,
sir. Strap spoiler is the criminal. Crew.
Look, Daniel, way to be rude. It's fine. Okay, we just had a lot to say about this. I'm just kidding. Not trying to actually call you out. look, we'll let you guys all go. But yeah, thank you guys. That was a really fun discussion. And I like getting to talk to you guys about Joe Abercrombie and Best of Cold. And it's kind of fun. Liene and Jimmy, you guys are really rah, rah, rah about Abercrombie. Makes me want to read some more. So
read more. The best
maybe we'll do another live if I get caught up to you guys and we have read all of the first lot.
Got another book coming out.
Yeah. Just
I know,
you,
right? It's like in October or something. That's coming
and
out.
I'm just warning you, if you don't like Age of Madness, it will be 3v1. So because
that could be a great, I could handle it. It'd be fine.
Age of Madness is so good.
Get her.
it's almost weird to like Abercrombie and not Age of Madness. I don't
we'll find out, I guess. I've maybe seen, I can read them fast.
I looked up 1-star reviews for A Little Hatred.
Oh, I guess, yeah. If you're reading A Little Hatred, you probably read all the first ones. Anyway.
Bye, guys. Bye. See you guys later. Thank
you. Thanks for having me.